Las uvas, grapes. Miguel was the only one who could have taken the money orders. No one doubted that. Alfonso apologized to Esperanza, but Mama graciously said that Miguel must have needed the money to get to Northern California. Alfonso promised the money would be paid back, one way or another, and Esperanza knew it would be, but she was angry with Miguel. How dare he go into her valise and take what was not his, and after all her hard work? Mama seemed to get a little stronger every day, although she took many naps. Hortensia was happy that she was eating well, and every day Esperanza brought home just-picked fruit to tempt her. A few weeks later, Esperanza stood on the shed dock in the morning and marveled at the peaches, plums, and nectarines that poured into the shed. "How will we ever sort them all?" she asked. Josefina laughed. "One piece at a time, it gets done." They started with the small white clingstone peaches and then the larger yellow Albertas. Mama loved the white peaches, so Esperanza set aside a bag for her. Then after lunch, they sorted the flaming gold nectarines. Later that afternoon, they would still have to sort a few bushels of plums. Esperanza loved the elephant heart plums. Molted green on the outside and blood red on the inside, they were tangy and sweet at the same time. She stood in the midsummer sun during her lunch break and ate one, bent over so the juice wouldn't run down her chin. Josefina called to her. "Mira," she said. "Look, there's Alfonso. What's he doing here?" Alfonso was talking to one of the other supervisors. He had never left the fields in the middle of the day to come to the sheds. "Something must be wrong," said Esperanza. "Maybe it's the babies," said Josefina and hurried towards him. Esperanza could see them talking and slowly began walking toward them, leaving the line of women in the stacks and lugs of palms. She tried to read from Josefina's expressions whether something was wrong. Then Josefina turned to look at her. Esperanza felt the blood drain from her face, and she suddenly knew why Alfonso was here. It had to be Mama. The doctor had said she could have a relapse. Something must have happened to her. Esperanza suddenly felt weak, but she kept walking. "Is it Mama?" "No, no, I didn't mean to alarm you, Esperanza, but I need you to come with me. Hortensia is in the truck." "But it's so early." "It's okay. I talked to the supervisor." She followed him to the truck. Hortensia was waiting inside. "We got a message from Miguel," she said. "We are to meet him at the bus station in Bakersfield at 3 o'clock. He said he is coming from Los Angeles and that we should bring you. That's all we know." "But why would he want me to come?" asked Esperanza. "I can only hope that it's to apologize for his actions," said Hortensia. It was over 100 degrees. Hot wind whipped inside the cab. Esperanza felt the perspiration sliding down her skin beneath her dress. It felt strange to be riding to town on a work day, breaking her routine in the sheds. She kept thinking of all the elephant hearts the others would have to pack shorthanded. Hortensia squeezed her hand. "I can't wait to see him," she said. Esperanza offered a tight smile. They arrived at the bus station and sat on a bench in front. The clerks all spoke to one another in English, their hard, sharp words meaning nothing to Esperanza. It always startled her when she heard English, and she hated not knowing what people were saying. Someday she would learn it. She strained to hear each announcement that was made, finally hearing the words that she was waiting for. Los Angeles. A silver bus turned the corner and pulled into the bay in front of her station. Esperanza searched through the passengers seated on the bus, but couldn't see Miguel. She and Hortensio and Alfonso stood up and watched everyone get off. And then finally, there was Miguel standing in the doorway of the bus. He looked tired and rumpled, but when he saw his parents, he jumped from the steps, grabbing his mother and hugging her, and his father and clapping him on the back. He looked at Esperanza and smiled. "I have brought you proof that all things will get better," he said. She looked at him, trying to be angry, but she didn't want him to think she was glad to see him. "Did you bring back what you have stolen?" "No, but I brought you something better." Then he turned to help the last passenger from the bus, a small, older woman trying to get down the steep steps. The sun, reflecting off this shiny bus, glinted in Esperanza's eyes. She shaded them with her hand, trying to imagine what Miguel was talking about. For a moment, she saw un fantasma, a ghost of Abuelita, walking towards her, with one arm reaching out to her and another pressing on a wooden cane. "Esperanza," said the ghost. She heard Hortensia second her breath. Suddenly, Esperanza knew that her eyes were not deceiving her. Her throat tightened and she felt as if she couldn't move. Abuelita came closer. She was small and wrinkled, with wisps of white hair falling out of her bun at the back of her head. Her clothes looked mussed from the travel, but she had her same white lace handkerchief tucked into the sleeve of her dress, and her eyes brimmed with tears. Esperanza tried to say her name but couldn't. Her throat was cramping from her emotions. She could only reach out for her grandmother and bury her head in the familiar smell of face powder, garlic, and peppermint. Abuelita, Abuelita, she cried. Aquí estoy, I am here, mi nieta. Oh, how I have missed you. Esperanza rocked her back and forth, daring to believe that it was true, looking at her through tears to make sure she was not dreaming, and laughing finally, laughing and smiling and holding her hands. Then Hortensia and Alfonso took their turns. Esperanza looked at Miguel. How? She asked. I needed to have something to do while I waited for work, so I went for her. After they pulled into the camp, they escorted Abuelita into their cabin, where they found Josefina, Juan, and the babies waiting. Josefina, where's Mama? It was warm, so we settled her in the shade. She fell asleep. Isabel is sitting with her. Is everything all right? Hortensia introduced Abuelita to Juan and Josefina, whose faces lit up. Esperanza then watched her grandmother look around the tiny room that now held pieces of her new life. Isabel's pictures on the wall, a bowl of peaches on the table, the boy's toys, the baby's toys underfoot, Papa's roses in the coffee can. Esperanza wondered what Abuelita thought of the sad conditions, but just smiled and said, "Please take me to my daughter." Esperanza took Abuelita's hand and led her towards the trees. She could see Mama reclining in the shade near the wooden table. A quilt was spread on the ground nearby where the babies usually played. Isabel was running back from the vineyard, her hands full of wildflowers and grapevines. She saw Esperanza and ran towards her and Abuelita. Isabel stopped in front of them, her face flushed and smiling. Isabel, this is Abuelita. Isabel's eyes widened and her mouth popped open in surprise. Do you really walk barefoot in the grapes and carry smooth stones in your pockets? Abuelita laughed, reached deep into the pockets of her dress, and pulled out a flat, slick stone and gave it to Isabel. She looked at it in amazement and then handed Abuelita the wildflowers. I think you and I will be good friends, Isabel, yes? Isabel nodded and stepped aside so that Abuelita could go to her daughter. There was no way to prepare Mama. Esperanza watched Abuelita walk to where Mama slept, resting on the makeshift lounge. She was framed by the vineyard, their grapes ripe and ready to drop. Abuelita stopped a few feet from Mama and looked at her. A stack of lace carpetas was at Mama's side, as well as her crochet needle and thread. Abuelita reached out and stroked her hair, gently pulling the loose strands away from Mama's face and smoothing them against her head. Softly, Abuelita said, "Ramona." Mama did not open her eyes, but said as if she was dreaming, "Esperanza, is that you?" "No, Ramona, it's me, Abuelita." Mama slowly opened her eyes. She stared at Abuelita with no reaction, as if she was not seeing her at all. Then she lifted her hand and reached out to touch her mother's face, making sure that the vision was true. Abuelita nodded, "Yes, it's me, I have come." Abuelita and Mama uttered no words that anyone could understand. It was their own language of happy exclamations and overwhelming emotions. Esperanza watched them cry, and she wondered if her own heart would burst from so much joy. "Oh, Esperanza," said Isabel, jumping up and down clapping. "I think my heart is dancing." Esperanza barely choked out the whisper, "Mine too." Then she picked up Isabel and spun her around in her arms. Mama would not let go of Abuelita. She scooted over and made Abuelita sit next to her and held onto her arms as if she might disappear. Suddenly, Esperanza remembered her promise, ran back into the cabin, and returned carrying something in her arms. "Esperanza," said Abuelita, "could that possibly be my blanket? Did you finish it?" "Not yet," she said, unfolding the blanket. Mama held one end and Esperanza pulled on the other end. It reached from the chinaberry tree to the mulberry. It could have covered three beds. They all laughed. The yarn was still connected, waiting for the last row to be finished. They all gathered onto the quilt They all gathered on the quilt and at the table. Esperanza sat down and pulled the massive blanket next to her, took her needle, and began crocheting the final stitches. When Mama could finally speak, she looked at Abuelita and asked the same thing that Esperanza had asked. How did you get here? Miguel, said Abuelita. He came for me. Luis and Marco have been impossible. If I went to the market, one of their spies would follow me. I think they thought you were still in the area and would eventually come back for me. 10 stitches to the top of the mountain. Esperanza listened to Abuelita tell Mama about how infuriated Tia Luis had been when he found out they were gone. He'd become obsessed with finding them and questions all their neighbors, including Senora Rodriguez. They had even come to the convent to question her sisters, but no one told him anything. Add one stitch. A few months after they left, she'd had a premonition that something was wrong with Mama. The feeling would not let go of her, so she lit candles every day for months and prayed for their safety. 9 stitches down to the bottom of the valley. Then one day, when she had almost given up hope, she found an injured bird in the garden that she did not think would fly again. But the next morning when she approached it, the bird lifted into the sky. She knew that it was a sign that whatever had been wrong was better. Skip 1 stitch. Then one of the nuns brought her a note that someone had left in the poor box addressed to her. It had been from Miguel. He suspected that Abuelita was being watched, so he delivered his notes after dark, telling her of his plan. 10 stitches up to the top of the mountain. Miguel and Senor Rodriguez came in the middle of the night and took her to the train station. It was all very exciting, and Miguel didn't leave her side once during the entire trip. He brought her all the way here. Add 1 stitch. He said that Ramona and Esperanza needed her. He was right, said Mama, her eyes teary again, gratefully looking at Miguel. Mountains and valleys, so many of them, thought Esperanza. When a strand of her hair fell into her lap, she picked it up and wove it into the blanket so that all of the happiness and emotions that she felt at this moment would go on forever. When Esperanza told Abuelita their story about all that had happened to them, she didn't measure time by the usual seasons. Instead, she told it as a field worker in spans of fruits and vegetables and by what needed to be done to the land. They had arrived in the valley at the end of the grapes. Thompson seedless, red Malagas, and the blue-black ribers. Mama breathed in the dust at the end of the grapes, and that's when she got sick. Then it had been time to prune the grapes and get ready for potatoes. Working potatoes was the heart of the winter and the cold that dampens the bones. And during potato eyes, Mama had gone to the hospital. There had been no months with names, only the time of tying canes amidst the ghosts of grapes and the gray days that never warmed. But afterward came the anticipation of spring in the valley pregnant with needs, graceful asparagus, ripening vineyards, and groaning trees. Then early peaches called, crickets in the field started their nightly symphonies, and Mama came home. Abuelita arrived during plums, and now the grapes were delivering another harvest. And Esperanza was turning another year.